So hello friends, I'm Abhijit Singh. I work as a software engineer at Uber. Today I'm going to talk about the potential of rot response in the Linux kernel. So I have only 10 minutes. Without further ado, let's begin. So let's talk about what static trace points in the kernel mean. So think of this. So in the Linux kernel, it provides various hooks at specific places to call a custom function at runtime. So basically, which means that in the kernel code, we have accessibility to plug into those functions and define our own functions, which can get visibility into what is happening at that particular function. So these hooks, which in a Linux kernel provides us, are basically trace points. And these hooks are defined at important events, and these are predefined. So this is not dynamic. These are predefined points in the code where we can plug our custom code and see what is happening in that function. So for example, we have the sked switch trace point, which is defined when a process context switches. We have this sked wake up trace point, which is defined when a process decides to, or when a process is woken up. So at various interesting places in the kernel code, we have these hooks defined. And when we define a particular function to plug into these hooks, we can get to know what the system is doing. So how do we plug into these hooks? How do we instrument what is happening at these particular hooks? So we can instrument them via BPA programs, ftrace, existing infrastructure that is available in the Linux kernel itself. So how does a trace point look like in the Linux kernel? So let's try to explore this. So we have the trace event macro. So this defines a unique trace point. So here you see sked switch. So it means that this is a unique trace point. You have the TP proto macro. So what this defines is that whatever function we write to plug into the trace points, that function has to obey this particular signature. So if we define a function which wants to instrument some particular data happening in this particular trace point, then the type of that function has to be a Boolean and then a pointer to a task struct and then another pointer to a task struct. So only then will our function be valid and we will be able to hook into this particular trace point. So here you see the previous task struct pointer and the next is the old one to be scheduled. So what if we don't define our particular hooks? So will the trace point still work? If we enable it, yes, it will work. And we can also see the trace data at this particular location. So what will be the information that will be logged when we enable the trace point? So by default, the information that will be logged is defined via TP struct entry. So here you see a bunch of fields being defined in this macro. So these are the particular fields which will be instrumented or logged in the buffer, and we can have visibility when we enable this particular trace point. So basically each trace point will define its own TP struct entry macro and will have its own TP struct, will have its own information being logged to the trace buffer. And that format will differ for different trace points. So the fields which have been written here, they obviously depend on what arguments are going to be passed to the trace point. Now, what we notice here is that there are only seven fields here. So a task struct can have a lot of fields and we are definitely not logging those attributes as well. And there's a reason, because the trace buffer is a ring buffer and a ring buffer is limited in capacity, memory capacity. So we cannot log all the attributes of task struct. But if we want to do that, or if we want to log few attributes which might be interesting to us, then we can use raw BPF trace points. So here, I mean, a person, a user might be interested in logging the memory descriptor or the non-voluntary context switches or the runtime, vRuntime attributes of the task struct, and the default macro doesn't log them. So we have to define a custom program to start logging them. So are trace points enabled by default? No. So we have to enable a trace point by running this echo command. So once this echo command is run, the trace points are enabled and the logs or the information starts to get accumulated in this particular location. So if we look at this particular location, we can see the logs being instrumented by the kernel if we do not define a particular hook. So if we define a particular hook for a particular trace point, then we can get our own type of logging, but by default, the kernel will use the information contained from tpstruct entry in the logs. So this is what the logs look like in the tracing buffer. So as you can see on the right side of sked switch, we have multiple attributes and their values being logged. So the name of the previous process, the name of the previous bit, the priority of the previous process, the state of the previous process, the next name of the process, and the next bit, next priority. And this conforms. So this conforms to the information that was defined in tpstruct entry macro. So what if we want more attributes or more information to be instrumented? Can we do that? Yes. So if we define BPF programs with BPF raw trace point type, then we get passed all the arguments which are defined in a trace point. So here in this case, let's say if we define a BPF program, then that BPF program will get passed a preempt flag, the task struct pointer, the previous task struct pointer, and the next task struct pointer. So whatever information is there in the previous task struct pointer and next task struct pointer, we can instrument that and we can serve our purpose. So basically all the attributes which are accessible via these arguments are available for instrumentation. So here I have actually written a BPF program to compute the time slice. So what do we define a time slice as? So consider these two particular timestamps. Timestamp one is when a process is scheduled to run on the CPU, and timestamp two is when a process is preempted from the CPU from running. So the difference between these two timestamps is the time slice. How do we calculate it? So basically what we have here defined is a function which plugs into the sked switch trace point and which gets passed this particular BPF raw trace point arguments parameter. So the first parameter of arguments, context arguments, is a task struct pointer, and we can convert this to a task struct pointer, and we have information now from previous variable, which is a pointer to the task struct type. So we can access the PID, we can access the utime. So what is a utime defined as? The utime is defined as the total number of the time the process has spent in user mode, the total time in the CPU. So basically, whenever a process is scheduled on the CPU and whenever it is preempted, so if we take a difference of the U times, we should get the value of time slice. So when is this trace point, when is this function called? So this function is called whenever the sked switch event happens in the kernel. And that event happens whenever a process is context switch happens. So any context switch will trigger this particular function call. And in this particular function call, what we are doing here is that we are calculating the U time of the previous process. We are getting the previous U time of this previous process by looking up from a map. So this BPF map lookup LM will look up from a map for this previous bid and return the previous U time. So the difference between the current U time and the previous U time will be the value of time slice. And once we compute the value of time slice, we can instrument that via the BPF trace printk function. So here you see the string that is being instrumented is different. The information is also different because we are instrumenting the bid. We're also instrumenting the time slice. Also in the middle, we update the map as well because we want to keep the map updated to get the correct time slices whenever the context switch happens. And the map is defined in the top section. So it is a standard BPF array, which is shared across all the CPUs. So because we want consistency across all the CPUs, so that's why it's shared. So why is it important? Why, like if we are able to write BPF programs and which can use rot response, why is this important? Because it basically unlocks a lot of possibilities. So it enables deeper debugging, deeper observability into what a kernel is doing. It is also a bit more efficient than the current tracing tools available in the kernel. And if we are able to fully leverage the attributes and the events, we can explore a lot of possibilities. So let's look at real world examples of this. So BCC is a BPF based Linux analysis tool. So it uses trace points, raw trace points to be precise, for various purposes. So RunQLAT is a tool which computes latency of the run queue for a process in the Linux scheduler for each CPU. So what is run queue latency? So you have two timestamps. Let's say the first timestamp is when a process is enqueued on the run queue, the scheduler run queue for a CPU. And the second timestamp is when a process is scheduled to run on the CPU. So the difference between these two particular timestamps is the run queue latency. So it instruments the run queue latency for all the processes in the system. So run queue slower is a variation of run queue latency. Just a minor variation is that we instrument only when the run queue latency exceeds a particular threshold value. So once it exceeds a particular threshold value, we instrument that particular process and latency. This might be quite interesting for us because it might we can try to check if there are any problems with the scheduler. Let's say if the run queue latencies using run queue slower are greater than 100 microseconds or 1 millisecond, then it definitely should be a problem with scheduler, or the scheduling process policies might be incorrect, or there might be another issue in the system. This helps us eliminate that if this run queue is a cause of concern or if it is not. In this way, several other tools can be written and can be imagined which can be based upon raw trace points. And this is an example of that. So that's it. All in all, I want to end is that using BPF and raw trace points, we can enable deeper observability into the system. We can instrument what the Linux kernel is doing with a lot of information that is not available via the default instrumentation provided by the kernel. So if you are able to plug into those hooks with our own BPF programs, we can do a lot of deeper observability then and do a lot of interesting analysis around what events are happening at in the system. Yeah, thank you. Please, questions.